The mecha genre is one that's been well past its prime for a good while now, but this video isn't about mecha as a whole, so I'll summarize that the big mecha shows from the past decade? Not great. The big shows, Guilty Crown, Darling in the Franxx, these are immensely flawed series that can't hold a candle to the greats of days past. And of course, no discussion about classic mecha would be complete without mentioning Studio Sunrise, the team behind such classics as the Big O, Escaflowne, and the legendary Gundam franchise. But we're not going quite that far back today, no. We're going back and looking at their smash hit of the 2000s. Gainax had Gurren Lagann, Bones had Eureka 7, and of course, Sunrise had Code Geass. With the recent announcement of the upcoming season, it's a convenient time to go back and revisit this series. Does it still hold up as well as Sunrise's other classics? Heh, well, that's what we're here to find out. This will be a story analysis on both seasons of the TV show, and will thus contain full spoilers for both seasons. I will not, however, be covering the sequel movie, Fukatsu no Lelouch, otherwise known as Lelouch of the Resurrection. It's technically a sequel to the recap movies, which admittedly only have a couple small changes, but I just want to look at the original run of the show for now. So, without further ado, let's take a look at Code Geass, Hangyaku no Lelouch. Code Geass Hangyaku no Lelouch, English title Lelouch of the Rebellion, aired from October 2006 to July 2007. It was created by director Goro Taniguchi alongside writer Ichiro Okochi. The show is set in an alternate timeline where the Britannian Empire, a not-so-subtle reference to the former British Empire, has conquered a third of the world, including glorious Nippon. The different territories of Britannia are referred to as zones, with Japan being Zone 11. Britannia rules with an iron fist, forcing the Japanese to live in ghettos and referring to them as 11s. I like how even though the country of Britannia is fictional, they still have their own derogatory, dehumanizing terms for their subjugated people. Whoa, just like a real empire. They also gun down civilians in the streets and in their own homes, for good measure, you know, just in case you didn't get the memo that these are the bad guys. Enter a young man named Lelouch V. Britannia, alias Lelouch Lamperouge, the son of the Emperor of Britannia, one Charles Z. Britannia, and the late Empress Marianne. Lelouch becomes disillusioned with his country due to the poor treatment from his father and the horrific acts of violence that he witnesses committed by Britannia. He thus vows to put a stop to it, largely so that he and his sister Nunnally can live in peace without needing to fear being made into political tools. But how does this young lad rebel against Britannia? Well, at the beginning of the series, he receives a power known as Geass. This ability allows Lelouch to issue a command to anyone he makes eye contact with, and that individual must follow that command. Wait a second, a protagonist with a supernatural power and a penchant for mind games? Yeah, it's certain that you've heard this series compared to Death Note at some point. Like Light Yagami, Lelouch is, of course, a high school student. And aside from the giant robot action, Code Geass spends a good bit of screen time in a high school academy, where Lelouch and his sister also happen to live. I guess it makes sense. Sunrise have stated that first and foremost, they wanted to make a show that appealed to as many people as possible. Giant robots are popular, school anime is popular, why not put them together? And if there's one thing I can congratulate the team on, it's that they definitely succeeded on that front. Code Geass was a smash hit and is still beloved today by tons of people, so good job, guys. Though I have to be honest, for such a popular series, the character designs are really unappealing to me. The designs were done by the all-female mangaka group Clamp, who've done art in the past for series such as Chobits, Holic, and Cardcaptor Sakura. And they also did, yeah. I don't know, I don't find these anorexic Jack Skellingtons well-suited for an action-packed mech series as much as something like, say, a Cardcaptor Sakura. As for the animation itself, it's usually competent, albeit not stellar or anything. The minimal use of CG for mechs is appreciated though, especially for a series from the late 2000s. But enough about the background stuff, it's time to dive deep into the series plot. That is what you came here for. In the opening scene, we see Lelouch and his Japanese friend Suzaku as young children. Suzaku, I... Britannia... After this introduction, the very first thing the audience sees Lelouch do is play a game of chess and completely own this shit-talking aristocrat. Get used to this motif, because the show loves using chess metaphors to describe how much of a genius Lelouch is. There's a clear correlation between Lelouch and the Black King, two figures seen together quite often. But as we go on, it becomes apparent that aside from this, the writer's knowledge of chess is superficial. After this little game, Lelouch goes on a joyride and encounters a group of terrorists transporting a giant stolen capsule, which presumably contains poison gas. He also runs into his old friend Zuzaku, who, as it turns out, has joined the Britannian army as an honorary Britannian. His defining character traits are established pretty quickly. He has a strict anti-killing policy, and he places the lives of others ahead of his own, as seen when he holds his gas mask over Lelouch's mouth instead of his own when the giant capsule opens. Speaking of which, what's really inside the large capsule turns out not to be poison gas, but a mysterious green-haired girl. Her name is CC.
C2?
C2. After finding out about C2, they're accosted by some Brits, or Britannians. They're still called Brits, though. They ask Suzaku to silence Lelouch for knowing too much. He of course refuses, and if you somehow didn't realize how villainous these guys were already, this is how they respond. Okay, before we get too into things, I have to admit, no. I don't believe Code Geass is on the same level as something like a Turne Gundam, a Cowboy Bebop, or a Gintama. I've obviously watched the show before I was inspired to make a video on it, so I have to admit, the question of whether or not Code Geass is on the same level of quality as The Best of Sunrise was a bit facetious. I had no idea what to expect getting into this series 11 years after its end, but unfortunately, I already had quite a few problems with this first episode. The most apparent is the pacing. It's just too damn quick. Lelouch's best friend appears out of nowhere, is revealed to be a Britannian soldier, and then he's gunned down, and we don't even take a breather for Lelouch to show emotion over his friend's supposed death? I guess there is no time to cry over this tragic event, what with Lelouch's back being literally against the wall. It's here that C2, after seemingly meeting an untimely end herself, bestows Lelouch with the power of Geass, and we immediately get to witness its grisly potential.
Yes, Your Highness!
Honestly though, the pacing of this episode is actually a bit misleading. I already mentioned how brisk the pacing of this episode was, but so many things are established. The Empire, several characters are introduced, two characters on the poster are already seemingly killed off, the introduction of Geass, the terrorists. Things move a bit too fast in this episode, but if anything, the rest of the series drags out a lot of its arcs and plotlines for too long. After this introduction, we see Lelouch testing out the Geass's capabilities by attempting to steal an enemy mech. We learn that the Geass is only effective if Lelouch is maintaining direct eye contact with the victim. That's all well and good, it's cool to learn more about the abilities of the new power through trial and error, but couldn't C2 have, you know, told Lelouch about this when she was making a contract with him? She said she wanted Lelouch to grant her a wish, so wouldn't you want to at least make absolutely certain he knows everything about this power so that he has the highest probability of surviving? And speaking of knowing about his power, why was Lelouch so confident when standing up to the soldiers? He didn't even know anything was going to happen when he told them to die, since all C2 told him was that he would inherit the power of kings. What if that power wasn't mind control at all, but was something like boosting his physical strength? If you want to make the argument that Lelouch instinctively knew how to use the Geass right away without C2 telling him anything, then how does he not know anything else other than that he can control people with commands? I guess it was just a lucky coincidence that Lelouch accidentally did the thing that would get him out of danger. And so Lelouch takes the mech, which is referred to as a nightmare, knight spelled like a Middle Ages knight, little double entendre there. Without any sort of military training or anything, Lelouch is able to competently control a nightmare, keep fanservice terrorist character Callan alive, and outsmart Jeremiah, who is a distinguished Britannian knight himself. Oh, wait, I get it. He's good at mecha fights because he plays chess. It all makes sense now. Wait, when did you get this train full of mechs prepared? Did you know everything in the last hour was going to happen in advance? Yeah, how? Meanwhile, Suzaku is perfectly fine. I guess they didn't have him front and center on the poster for nothing. And despite also having no experience piloting a mech, along with just barely escaping a fatal injury and being an 11 on top of that, these guys think it's a good idea to give him one of Britannia's strongest mechs, Lancelot. Look, I know the writers obviously wanted to contrast the Japanese Suzaku being one of the biggest players for Britannia and the Britannian Lelouch being the biggest player for Japan, but not even Lelouch pulled some bullshit to get a super mech at this point. Suzaku getting a big OP mech this early on just seems a little forced. I think now's a good time to bring up that Code Geass, at least the first season, gets a lot of praise for the battle tactics. Well, those pretty much go out the window once this big fucker enters the field, or any of the other signature robots that characters like Lelouch or Kallen obtain. It's because these guys just annihilate everything with essentially no resistance. Good thing Lelouch escaped and got the enemy commander to call off his troops before we had to deal with these guys for real, huh? It's here that Lelouch confronts the enemy commander, Clovis, his half-brother, and uses his Geass on him to get information on his mother's death. Clovis doesn't know anything concrete, but says that Cornelia, another sibling of Lelouch, should know. Lelouch officially begins his trail of blood by killing his own sibling. You know, you'd think Lelouch would have ended up killing a lot more of his siblings by the end, honestly, if they wanted to go for that tragedy feel. Now that the skirmish is over, Lelouch returns to the school, and we find out another handicap of the Geass while he's using it on Kallen. It can only be used once per person. Sound like a big handicap? Considering the Geass has near limitless potential, it's really not. And it makes Lelouch look kind of stupid from this point on when he uses the Geass to get out of a short-term problem. I'll elaborate when we learn more about the capability of the Geass in R2. Well, the show is called Lelouch of the Rebellion, so in order to get the actual rebellion plot underway, Lelouch asks for the assistance of the revolutionaries directly and asks them to join with him. Now, of course, he can't just go meet them in his school uniform, so here's where Zero comes in, and we find out how much of a cosplay nerd Lelouch is. I admit, the Zero outfit is a bit cool in a choony sort of way, but can Kallen really not tell who this is after she had just been talking to Lelouch several times in the past day? It's never mentioned whether or not Lelouch is using some sort of voice modification device. Just because he's wearing a mask doesn't mean you can't still recognize his voice. Usually, if a character is trying to hide their identity by wearing a mask, they won't speak until their mask comes off, let alone speak on a televised broadcast. I know Code Geass is far from the only example of this, but it still irks me. Of course, the revolutionaries aren't just going to start listening to some rando, understandably, so Lelouch needs to show them his capabilities. He sets a plan in motion to rescue Suzaku, who's being transported down the street as a prisoner. Damn, the chain of command in Britannia is a clusterfuck. First he's shot for disobedience, then he's given a super overpowered battle robot, and now he's being held on trial for killing Clovis. To give credit where credit is due, Lelouch's plan here is actually well thought out. He meets the Britannians with his own transport vehicle, bringing along the giant poison gas capsule. Lelouch threatens to open the capsule if the Britannians don't hand over Suzaku. This would supposedly kill everyone, including the surrounding citizens. C2 was being kept a secret for most of the Britannian military, so even they don't know that there's not actually poison gas inside. Here's another clever trick from Lelouch. While talking over terms with Jeremiah, he says that if he dies, everything about Orange will be leaked to the public. What's Orange, you ask? Well, Orange doesn't actually mean anything, it's just some bullshit Lelouch made up on the spot. Of course, none of these other clowns know the validity of his accusation. Lelouch then uses his Geass on Jeremiah to make sure he can pass unharmed, right after supposedly giving Jeremiah a reason to obey him. Great timing on Lelouch's part. Now Jeremiah has been humiliated by Zero in front of all of his comrades, and in addition, now they suspect he's a double agent. The rivalry between the two is built up pretty well, I have to admit. After Suzaku is brought to a safe hideout, Lelouch attempts to convince him to join forces. He refuses, with this being his justification. I get that Suzaku is immensely altruistic, but do you not realize what kinds of people you're working with? Look, I get not believing in the whole ends justify the means approach, but aren't the means of working with a genocidal dictatorship quite a bit more reprehensible than what Lelouch is doing? A real Himura Kenshin, this one. My understanding is that the series was trying to portray gray morality concerning the dynamic between Suzaku and Lelouch, but unfortunately, this attempt failed completely because the hypocrisy is far too one-sided. Let's actually take a second to look at the goals of these two. Lelouch's goal is to destroy a totalitarian dictatorship so that his sister can live in peace. You can make the point that Lelouch is no better than his father because his rebellion will unavoidably result in unintended casualties, but I would disagree because Lelouch is seen in several instances making attempts to avoid unnecessary casualties, something Britannia would absolutely not do. He has character flaws, yes, but at least his actions and his goal are congruent with each other. How Suzaku goes about achieving his goal makes no sense, though. He is 100% against killing others, and later on even says that achieving a goal through killing is never justified, yet he literally works for genocidal maniacs. Not only is this some peak hypocrisy, but it's also peak stupidity. Suzaku fails as a character because his actions make absolutely no sense given his motives. When Lelouch gets back home, he finds out that the writers have a really bad track record of actually killing people off so far. Yep, it turns out C2 is immortal due to her magic Geass powers. I'm just wondering, how did she get here unspotted by the Britannians? Lelouch didn't know she was alive, so it couldn't have been that she just snuck back in the capsule. But I guess without her, we wouldn't have an excuse to have all of these Pizza Hut product placements. Who am I kidding? They'd still be here. The Code Geass Pizza Hut tie-in is really surreal. Yeah, there are a few goofy moments in the series, but I'd say it takes itself a lot more seriously than most serious anime most of the time. If you're being charitable, you could call the Pizza Hut ads an Easter egg, like the black cat from Trigun. But the Trigun cat had charm, and you knew they were just being silly with it. All I get from this is cold, soulless commercialism. We have these moments of death and tragedy, and then the same episode, a reminder to order Pizza Hut pizza. Though this is the same studio who'd go on to make Tiger and Bunny, so I guess I shouldn't be surprised. I like C2 though, for the most part. Aside from the obvious reasons, I love how she just doesn't take anyone's shit. Unfortunately, her character gets kind of butchered when her lame backstory comes into play. It's a shame. Also, her theme song is awful. Up next, we get to meet another member of Lelouch's extended family, Princess Euphemia. Man, speaking of awful music. The soundtrack for Code Geass is pretty decent, and there are actually several great tracks, particularly during the action scenes. But these two songs, they just don't do it for me. In this next bit, the Geass sort of gets more fleshed out. Lelouch tries to find out the maximum duration his Geass can last on a person by commanding a random student to do the same thing every day. I say sort of because we never get a concrete answer. Hell, it can probably last forever if we're going off of R2. Our next scene with Jeremiah reveals he's been demoted to a basic grunt, so not much has changed. Though his fellow Britannians are trying to kill him off due to that whole orange business. Boy, I can't wait to see where his character will go from here. We're not going to get any character progression for a bit though, because now it's time for the fucking cat episode. The cat steals the fucking Zero mask. So... I mentioned before that Code Geass is a mecha and a school anime. The problem is, the school half of the show is, well, it's a bit shit. Most of the subplots are filler, and even the characters are just there for filler. The dorky friend, the class president, none of these characters are interesting or have much relevance to the plot. Even Shirley's importance is limited to largely self-contained subplots. The only one who does anything important is Nina, who creates a nuke in R2. That's pretty much it. Come on now, it's impossible to call things like this. Anything but filler. After this bit, Lelouch has to deal with the Japanese Liberation Front, a separate revolutionary group which he says are dumb and bad, basically. You know, it's kind of ironic that we, the audience, get to see the plans of the Britannians laid out, but we don't get to see what the protagonist is thinking. You know, the one we should ideally be rooting for? See, the writing makes it seem like Lelouch is supposed to be a genius because he plans everything out to the smallest degree, but it's hard to actually see him as a genius when we don't actually get to see his plans laid out. Then when something outrageous happens, it just seems like an asspull, to say nothing of the actual assholes Lelouch gets away with later in the second season. Somebody sure liked Akito the Exiled, huh? You get it? Nobody saw that aside from me. Hey, if the building's entire foundation was destroyed, shouldn't the power be out in the entire building? Why do the lights go out several at a time? I guess it was because it just looked cooler that way. Finally, we have a name for our ragtag band of revolutionaries, the Black Knights. And of course, it's something chess related. Man, this guy can't get enough of his chess. We also hear one of Lelouch's most iconic lines. A pretty generic quote for a war story, but yes, it serves as heavy foreshadowing. To be fair at least, it's not as heavy-handed as a lot of other foreshadowing in this show. This subplot about Callan's mom being hooked on drugs sure is depressing. I don't know about you, but this all really has me in the mood for a large stuffed crust pizza from Pizza Hut.
Полный хаос!
Перспективы!
Политическая нестабильность!
Да благодаря ему, у нас есть Pizza Hut!
За Горбачёва!
За Горбачёва!
За Горбачёва!
Guys, I wouldn't eat on that table if I were you. Ew. You know what? I'm not hungry anymore. We're about to have some more battles coming up, but our group isn't really that large, so we're gonna need to recruit some more people. How? On the internet. Brilliant. Let's hope these guys were all smart enough to use VPNs, eh? In the next big fight, consumed with rage toward Zero, Jeremiah charges into battle and meets his end. In the end, his personal grudge was his downfall. Maybe a bit of foreshadowing regarding someone else we know with their own vendetta? Putting the actual ending aside. I gotta say, Jeremiah was a decent minor villain. Oh, he ejected out of his robot and got picked up by some randos. And then Charles saves his life and turns him into a cyborg. Huh. Anyway, the next arc is one of my least favorites in this season. To recap, in the previous battle, Lelouch caused a massive landslide to block off the Britannians' retreat. In doing so, several civilian lives were lost as collateral damage, and it just so happens, one of those was the father of Shirley. So of course, Shirley finds out that Lelouch is Zero, the man responsible for her father's death. Things get a lot more complicated when this chuckle fuck over here kidnaps Shirley and uses her as bait to lure over Lelouch. Turns out his name is Mao. No, not that Mao. More importantly, he happens to have a Geass. Oh shit, things are getting real now. To clarify, he doesn't have the same power as Lelouch, otherwise he'd probably have a much more difficult time dealing with this guy. No, Mao's Geass isn't mind control, but rather mind reading. Mao, like Lelouch, also received his power from C2, which raises a lot of questions for me, none of which are answered. Kind of a running theme with the Geass powers. What determines who obtains which power? Is it up to C2, or is it just random chance? Lelouch never specified the power he wanted, so for all we know, it could be either one of these. Gee, it sure was convenient that Lelouch happened to get the power that would be the most advantageous in amassing a massive army and defeating an empire. But at this point, you might be thinking, okay, well, this idiot isn't in a mech or anything, so Lelouch can just immediately command this loser to kill himself. No. You see, he's immune to the Geass because of his sunglasses. Yeah, this visor-looking thing? They're purple sunglasses. Whew. It was established early on that the Geass, oh wait, I can't call it that anymore because all of these goddamn powers are referred to as Geass. Lelouch's Geass can only work if someone is making direct eye contact with him, but you can still see someone's goddamn eyes when they're wearing sunglasses. Lelouch even said himself in episode 5,
Geass を使うには相手の目を直接見る必要がある。メガネ程度の透過率なら問題はない。
Oh, but sunglasses aren't only good for warning off the harsh rays of the sun, but Geass as well. I'm usually in favor of the rule of cool, but not this time. Seriously, everything about this character and his arc just screams bad writing. Basically, he's a yandere who's hardcore simping for C2, and he wants to kill Lelouch so he can have her for himself. But this guy is too stupid to just shoot Lelouch and get it over with. Instead, he tries to manipulate Shirley into killing him. This, of course, doesn't end how he wants it to. C2? Why are you holding him at gunpoint if you're not going to shoot him? We're gonna drag this arc out, huh? With everything that's happened in the last couple episodes, Shirley is understandably a bit of a mess. So, in a display of his kind heart, Lelouch commands her to forget about him completely. Yep, her entire character arc was pointless. It all gets undone. Unfortunately, Mao's arc isn't over, and we learn a bit more about his power through C2. A big disadvantage of his power is that he can't turn it off, which is why it's only really effective in secluded areas. This is also the big reason why he's so crazy about C2. She's the only one who Mao can't read the thoughts of, since Geass doesn't work on her. C2 decides to go off on her own and put an end to his bullshit, but Lelouch isn't having any of it, even though she does have the advantage over Mao in the form of immortality. So Lelouch tries to make her stay by using Geass, and of course it doesn't work, duh. Why do you look so smug here? He already knew that. I'm starting to think that Lelouch might not be too smart, guys. It turns out that C2 must be really bad at shooting someone because she gets instantly owned by Mao. After he's bested her, he does this. I hope you know I pack a chainsaw. Yeah, he was just hiding a chainsaw at the amusement park. Makes total sense. I don't want to get into how stupid this scene is just conceptually. Shit like this really does only happen in anime. Of course, we can't actually have our resident pizza girl killed off, so Lelouch comes in to save the day at the last minute. First, he broadcasts to this giant monitor and just absolutely shits all over Mao. Beautiful. While Mao's monkey brain is focused on that, Lelouch has a bunch of cops around him, and they finally put him out of his misery. Oh what, you thought he was actually dead? Of course not. He only got shot by like 20 cops, he can walk that off. Did we really need to drag out this arc for yet another episode? More importantly, Mao not being dead is especially hard to believe given Lelouch's character. How can he plan out all these factors in battle and seize victory against a group of trained soldiers and giant robots, but he can't kill one guy? This is inconsistent character writing, and Lelouch ends up looking like a total idiot for the sake of plot convenience. All he had to do was order the cops to kill Mao. And no, Mao addressing this fact does not make it any better. I can believe that Lelouch is a human being and that he's capable of making mistakes, but not that he set up this checkmate situation and didn't even accomplish the thing he set out to do. You can't just have your protagonist be a cunning strategist when you want him to be, and then have him be a moron when you want him to be. Mao's brilliant scheme to deal with Lelouch this time is to waltz onto the high school in broad daylight and kidnap Nunnally. In addition, he somehow built a human-sized bomb under the school. Yeah, okay. While Suzaku sits here and attempts to dismantle the bomb, Lelouch goes to confront Mao, who's eagerly awaiting him. This next scene is straight out of a D-tier action thriller. Mao challenges Lelouch to a game of chess, because of course. Any pieces that are lost go into either side of this scale, which is connected to the detonation mechanism of the bomb. If the scale tips far enough towards Lelouch, the bomb will be deactivated. But if it swings too far towards Mao, it will immediately detonate. Pretty tense scenario here. Only problem? Why doesn't Lelouch just, press down on the scale with his own weight and immediately deactivate the bomb? If a good 10 chess pieces are enough to move the scale far enough, surely even this lanklet can press down that hard. Obviously, since Mao has the advantage of mind reading, he easily wins against this supposed chess pro. Of course, Nunnally doesn't die in an explosion because Suzaku dismantled the bomb while this scene was happening. How did Mao not know this if he can read Lelouch's mind? Well... Okay, so Lelouch did mention several episodes ago that the Geass can work through reflected light, but if Lelouch's Geass can work on himself, then this opens up a whole new can of worms. You know you can see your own reflection in someone's eyes too, right? Sorry to be that guy and reference JoJo for a second time in a video where it's not even the focus, but even Stardust Crusaders was smart enough to realize this, man. If Lelouch can use the Geass on himself by looking in a mirror, then surely the same can be true by looking in someone else's eyes. Hey, by this logic, shouldn't Lelouch's first command have also affected himself? What was that again? Fan theory, when Lelouch told those guys in the first episode to kill themselves, he also accidentally commanded himself to commit suicide, and the rest of the series is his dying dream. Everything implausible about this series makes sense now. Anyway, Suzaku comes crashing through the window, and with the power of ninjutsu, or whatever the fuck, kicks Mao's ass. At this point, I'm thinking the only reason Mao was kept alive this long was so that he could reveal Suzaku's backstory with his Geass powers. Several years ago, war broke out between Britannia and some Japanese rebels over Sakuradite, a precious material. Suzaku's dad was one of the big shots in the rebellion, so baby Suzaku got the bright idea that if he killed his father, he could end the conflict. This is the moment that molded Suzaku's anti-ends-justifying-the-means stance, but that was simply idiotic. At least, unlike Lelouch, Suzaku's stupidity is consistent. Well, in this season anyway. Mao starts rightfully putting Suzaku in his place. Man, you know you're in the wrong when I'm cheering for a verbal beatdown from Mao. Unfortunately, Lelouch puts a stop to it. Mao runs out. And finally, for real this time, C2 learns how to use a gun properly. Wait, she just shot this guy on school grounds. How did she hide the body? Why is Suzaku not doing anything being the goody-two-shoes no-killing prude that he is? Ah, whatever. Anything to be done with this god-awful arc. We're gonna be seeing a lot more of Suzaku for a bit. He's finally built up as one of the primary antagonists, and Lelouch learns it was none other than Suzaku piloting OP Super Mech Lancelot. Princess Euphemia, yeah, remember her, then names him her knight. Friend fighting friend, who could have seen this tragic outcome? Well, Suzaku's the new hot shit, so of course, he becomes an immediate target of the Black Knights. The Britannian military is up to some stuff on this one island, so the Black Knights decide to ambush them. How did they know they were coming here? Not because they had a spy or anything, it was posted on the internet. You'd think Britannia would police the internet a bit more, especially with there being a revolution and all, but whatever. The Black Knights' plans succeed at first, and they capture Suzaku in a sort of mech jamming circle made with Sakuradite. Lelouch understandably doesn't want to kill his chum, so he tries in vain again to get him to join him. Suzaku pulls the ends don't justify the means crap again, only for Lelouch to own him with facts and logic. If Suzaku supports the peace Japan has now, he is supporting a peace that was obtained through Suzaku's own act of bloodshed. Again, Suzaku is a hypocrite, and this show fails at gray morality. Suddenly, Suzaku gets a call from the higher-ups, telling him to do everything in his power to keep Lelouch held in the area while they drop missiles. Suzaku attempts to sacrifice his life this time in order to end another life. You know, something that runs completely opposite to his altruistic beliefs. His back against the wall, Lelouch issues a command to Suzaku in what ends up being one of the funniest plot points in the series. Suzaku ends up fleeing the area, and in the next episode, we see him stranded on the beach of another island. It's time for a plot hole lightning round. Lelouch's command was that Suzaku should live, but why did he need to flee all the way to a completely different island to do that? Where the hell did his mech go? How did Lelouch get separated from him? How did Euphemia and Callan get here? I can buy that Lelouch might have been in Lancelot's cockpit along with Suzaku, but where is Callan's mech? How were the Britannians able to lose sight of two mechs when they were right above them? Why was Callan over here bathing when she knew an enemy was nearby? I suppose we just really needed a shot of her nipples. It was also really convenient that the big mech expert on the Britannian side just so happened to be on this island, and that they had mechs ready for Lelouch and Callan to hijack and fly out of here. But not before, also conveniently, triggering this pillar in the island to come down right in the middle here. Fuck, at this point I was watching more because I wanted to know what shit the writers would pull next. Sadly, the next episode is filler, where Lelouch and Suzaku fight against China.
China!
I don't have anything else to say about this episode, I just really wanted to use that clip. The episode after this should have also been filler, I mean it revolves around mechs making pizzas, for God's sake. But in a staggering display of tone deafness, this episode has an important plot point going on at the same time. Euphemia realizes that Lelouch is Zero, and meets with him in an attempt to talk things over peacefully. He's not having any of it, but Euphemia is quickly spotted by the students while they're talking. This leads to the actual saddest moment in this show. Afterwards, she makes this bold declaration. This kind of defeats the purpose of the whole rebellion. But there are 4 episodes left in this season, and we can't just have this tragic war series end with both sides anticlimactically deciding to resolve things peacefully. Right, Gundam 00? We're about due for another big contrivance. And with an episode title like Bloodstained Yuffie, yeah, we're gearing up for some serious shit here. Early in the episode, Lelouch just says fuck it and tries to kill this rando, but his Gia seems to malfunction, as seen by it not having any effect. Lelouch even winces in pain after this. Surely this could have no bearing on events later in the episode, though. Euphemia is planning on publicly announcing the beginning of the specially administered zone of Japan to a giant stadium of people. Lelouch makes his entrance in the boldest way possible, and then asks to speak to Euphemia in private. And these guys just let him go, without even being under the effect of Gias. Brilliant. Lelouch, of course, has a plan to make sure the rebellion continues. This plan involves commanding Euphemia to shoot him with a needle gun. According to Lelouch, this would then prompt a riot in response to Yuffie's betrayal. Surprisingly though, Euphemia is able to talk him out of it pretty easily, and they agree to terms of peace. But alas, Lelouch's Gias just so happens to permanently malfunction at this moment, basically making it so he can't turn it off, and Lelouch coincidentally happens to say this phrase right as he makes eye contact with Euphemia. So Yuffie actually goes to do it. By the way, why did she shoot her guard when her only command was to kill the Japanese? Pretty sure this guy isn't Japanese. It's kind of a funny implication that someone controlled by the Geass would just kill someone if they were getting in the way of their command. Before I get too far off track, let's get back to the kill the Japanese scene itself. This whole moment is possibly the most contentious part of the first season of Code Geass, and I'd say for good reason. This scene doesn't destroy the plot with Titanic-sized holes or anything, at least not when compared to certain other moments, but there are too many conveniences for me to let it off the hook. The first thing to note is yes, Geass's going haywire was established previously during the Mao arc, but Lelouch's Geass going out of control wasn't really built up to aside from that. It worked perfectly until this very episode where it malfunctioned once, and then it just permanently turns on while he's talking to Yuffie. Also, the phrase, kill the Japanese, yes, is said in jest, but it's just not in the same wheelhouse as anything else Lelouch was saying. Shoot me. Relieve Suzaku from duty. These are both things that would actually greatly benefit Lelouch, and for him to then brag about how he could easily do something that goes entirely against his goals feels out of place. I have a pretty big issue with what this insinuates about the Geass as well. The fact that the command was successful means the Geass' effect is determined not by intent, but by words. Which is stupid. If you'll allow me to get a bit pretentious for a moment, words by themselves have no meaning. Words and language are tools which people give association to in order to communicate with each other. So why is this mystical god power determined by Japanese vocabulary? Again, it seems completely arbitrary. Even just as a piece of tragic writing, the scene misses the mark because Euphemia's death doesn't really end up leaving much of an impact on Lelouch later on. That, and there's just something really funny about this dainty princess mowing down civilians with a machine gun with killer mechs in the background. It felt like the writers just didn't know what to do with Euphemia anymore, since ultimately, this whole scenario leads to the same result that would have happened if Yuffie had just shot Lelouch. The rebellion continues. Lelouch catches up to her, and Yuffie is promptly dealt with.
Sayonara, Yuffie.
And Suzaku is quick to toss aside his anti-killing stance after his waifu is brought into it. Typical hypocrite. Ugh, this guy's voice acting is dreadful. He sounds like he's voiced by a child. Well, fun fact, he's voiced by Kazuto Tomizawa, who was actually 10 at the time. You know, there's a reason why child characters in animated series are typically voiced by adults. It's because in most cases, kids can't act. This is one of those cases. At the end of the season, the Black Knights take over the school, and not even Lelouch's own sister can recognize his voice. You'd think that if she can recognize Suzaku by touch after not seeing him for several years, surely she'd be able to recognize her own damn brother's voice. After Lelouch emerges victorious in a fight against Cornelia, he uses Geass to extract information about his mother. He learns that Marianne called off her own guards on the eve of her death. Information that will ultimately prove pointless in R2. After this, Lelouch learns Nunnally has been kidnapped, so he heads back to the island everyone washed up on a few episodes ago, where he meets Suzaku. Oh, and Callan's there too, I guess. After Lelouch fails to recruit Suzaku for the millionth time, Suzaku fires a bullet at Lelouch's mask. Bullshit, Suzaku. We both know you weren't intelligent enough to figure that out. This season finale is peak soap opera material. Suzaku and Lelouch both have guns aimed at each other, and Lelouch plants an object on his chest, which he claims is a liquid sacrodite bomb. This bomb will explode if Lelouch's heart stops beating, also killing Suzaku and Callan in the blast. Like every fictional object or ability in this series, the writers don't bother explaining sacrodite upon its introduction. They just make up shit as they go along so that it can be used to create artificial tension. I guess it doesn't really matter. Time for the funny cliffhanger. Season 1 is a dud for me. It has some promising elements in the first episodes, but a lot of it falls completely flat. Looking back on the season, it doesn't feel like much got accomplished. It would be fine if it was episodic, like how a large chunk of a Gundam series usually is, but Code Geass is mostly framed as a continuous narrative. For the first few episodes, there's always a hook for the next episode, something that gets your attention. As it goes on, however, there are just several time-wasting one-off episodes and arcs. I can't say it's not entertaining in a way, because there's a fair share of bombastic moments, but it's mostly just cheap melodrama. Most of all, Code Geass is nowhere near as intelligent as it thinks it is. The pacing wasn't great either. Ultimately, the only big things that had any integral role in the overarching plot that happened were Lelouch forming the Black Knights and Nunnally getting kidnapped. Now, to be fair, an ambitious series like this should pace itself properly and provide a sense of build-up so that the climax is more satisfying. I mean, it's not like Lelouch can immediately launch a full-scale assault on the Emperor. Season 2 of Code Geass, referred to as R2, began airing a year after the Season 1 cliffhanger, and also takes place a year after the first season. First episode, and we're already off to a disorienting start. Zero is said to be executed, but Lelouch is right here at school. Lelouch has no memories of being Zero, and suddenly has a brother named Rollo. Callan is wearing a bunny girl outfit. What is going on here? Not that I was expecting a satisfying payoff to these answers, considering the show's track record, but almost immediately I realized something while watching this season premiere. R2 is incredibly schlocky, even more so than Kill the Japanese, if you can believe that's possible. This becomes clear from the very first episode, and let me tell you, this season is pretty funny. After this wacky opener, Lelouch goes to an illegal gambling parlor, as a high school student does. Man, Callan sure has fallen on hard times since Zero got busted, huh? Of course, we can't go an episode without being reminded of Lelouch's chess fetish. Oh, it looks like he finally got exposed as a filthy cheater. Before the writers can further demonstrate their lack of knowledge of chess, the Black Knights, along with C2, make their attack on the building. This segment feels like a sort of homage to classic spy movies like James Bond, only this is so cheesy it feels like a parody, and I thought Bond was already full of cheese. We get some build-up to one of the later arcs, as we get hints that China will be more relevant this season. Now instead of a filler episode, they get a filler arc. God, this guy's voice acting is some of the worst I've ever heard in an anime. Please shut up. Please just stop talking. And no, sadly, this guy's voice isn't any better in the English dub.
My, an uncommonly straightforward approach.
Though I guess it's bearable if Nunnally's English voice doesn't make your ears bleed.
Thank goodness, I thought maybe you'd gotten caught up in all the uproar caused by that man Zero. I tried calling you, but you didn't answer your cell phone.
So mechs, explosions, Britannia kills dozens of innocents, blah blah blah. Business as usual. Lelouch finally runs into C2, and she brings back his memories by kissing him. Oh yeah, this is technically the second kiss between these two, not that it was an important scene in building these characters' relationship. For as much as either one of them seemed to care, it might as well just be shipbait. Wait a minute. Lelouch going for a ride with a friend, accidentally getting caught up in a terrorist plot, meeting C2 and awakening to his powers, and then having his first command be to make a bunch of soldiers kill themselves? This is just the same thing as the intro to the first season. He even makes a command to some guy in the next episode to give him his nightmare instead of, I don't know, doing something more useful like making this guy your permanent slave or something. The beginning of R2 is basically a soft reset. The redundancy of these episodes makes the majority of season 1 feel even more pointless. Somehow, even Suzaku knowing the identity of Zero gets reset for 16 entire episodes. Speaking of which, I should get into what happened after the Season 1 cliffhanger. Of course, both gunshots miss, and Suzaku spin kicks Lelouch's ass and drags him before the Emperor. Charles has a Geass, because he's the biggest antagonist in this series. I guess he just has to have one. Charles's ability can rewrite memories, so he wipes all of Lelouch's memories of being Zero, as well as his memories of Nunnally. Though this doesn't really explain how Lelouch's powers became dormant during this period. Couldn't he no longer control the Geass in the first place? It shouldn't even matter whether he remembers he can use it or not. As we saw with Euphemia, intent doesn't even matter when it comes to Geass usage. Charles then decides the best way to handle this kid that just tried to overthrow his country and also kill him is to just send him back to school. Why does Charles not simply kill Lelouch, or at least keep him close by so that he can monitor him? Okay, I know the real reason, but you'd think that Charles would at least keep a closer eye on him until he'd recaptured C2, you know, since there'd be less of a chance of him regaining his powers or memories. But this does explain how Rollo, who's also a child assassin by the way, is able to take the place of Nunnally. But wouldn't there have been a risk of someone saying something like, "Hey, whatever happened to your sister Nunnally? I haven't seen her in a while." There might be a chance I missed it, but I don't recall there being an instance where this was brought up. Oh yeah, and speaking of Rollo, he has a Geass, because everyone has a Geass now. Due to the piss-poor planning from Charles and Suzaku, Lelouch joins up with the Black Knights once again, to the surprise of no one, and resumes his epic quest to take back Japan from those filthy Brits. Wait a minute. Britannia doesn't even own Britain. Excuse me? You have all of these references to Great Britain. First off, Britannia is straight up just the Latin name for Britain. I already mentioned the nightmares, but Charles even has his own Knights of the Round in reference to the court of King Arthur. They also have another type of mech named after the Scottish city Glasgow. Hell, Suzaku's mech is even named after Lancelot, the Welsh knight of King Arthur's Round Table. I mean, okay, the story of Lancelot is French, but you get the point, okay? One would assume that with all of these references, Britannia would at least own the nation they're based on, but no, I guess that's just too on the nose for Code Geass. Lelouch announces Zero's return in a fashion that's all too in line with his character, hijacking a public broadcast. It's here that I'm reminded of the issue I have with Lelouch's voice while he's speaking under the guise of Zero. Seriously, how does no one recognize who it is? Even Suzaku and the other Britannians are wondering who could it possibly be, even though who else could it be? I guess technically it's not Lelouch in the broadcast, because C2's the one wearing the Zero suit. Callan's a bit surprised, seeing as it was obviously Lelouch's voice. Wait, so she can tell who it is? How the hell can no one else? Especially since the voiceover by Lelouch was recorded beforehand. According to the logic of this show, he must have made sure to wear a mask while he made the audio recording. Cause no one can tell who you are if you put on a mask. What is this, The Incredibles? I've already said multiple times that the beginning of this season sent us back to square one, but what about Lelouch's Geass powers? You know, there was that bit where Lelouch couldn't turn off his Geass and it resulted in the biggest tragedy in season 1? Well, apparently Okochi wasn't confident he could write an entire season where Lelouch couldn't control his Geass, so he keeps it covered with a contact lens. You can't make this shit up. Speaking of Geass, I haven't gotten to Rollo's. So, what is his power, you may ask? Well... Okay, you can't fault me for that outdated reference, because it's the exact same power. Real talk though, I think it's a bit disappointing that not every character's Geass is used through eye contact. Lelouch and Charles's are, but everyone else's in the TV series aren't really activated that way. They just have the Geass symbol in their eyes. They could have at least had another nice motif going. Seeing as how Rollo poses the most immediate threat to Lelouch, he's forced to deal with him right away, and the way this all goes down feels sloppy as hell. Rollo was given two objectives, capture C2 and monitor Lelouch. He was to kill Lelouch if his memories somehow came back. Held at gunpoint, Lelouch points out that he'll probably get a raw deal if he actually completes his mission, and then he basically talks out of his ass, saying that he can guarantee Rollo a better future if he sides with him. He even adds that he'll give Rollo C2 if he still wants to bring her in. So instead of taking the opportunity to achieve at least one of his two objectives, Rollo actually goes along with this shit. Rollo is still skeptical, and for good reason, but during this battle sequence where Lelouch frees the captured Black Knights, he literally takes a bullet for Rollo, and then says this.
お前と過ごしたあの時間に嘘はなかった。
And this is all it takes for Rollo to be completely swayed to the point where he doesn't even consider betraying Lelouch for the rest of the series.
What are you, fucking stupid?
Lelouch already demonstrated he wasn't going to hand over C2, so why should you trust anything he says? I mean, aside from the excuse to have a bro-con subplot for the Fujos, you'd think a professional government assassin wouldn't be this gullible. Finally, some good news. Now I'll never have to hear this man's awful voice acting again. Fuck. You know, Code Geass had a good amount of fan service in the first season. Callan pretty much only ever existed for getting naked and for an excuse to include jiggle physics and ass shots during the battle scenes. But R2 raises it up a notch. If you want your series to be full of hot babes and big tits, then go for it. But shoving shit like this... in your serious war tragedy series feels like a big clash. Technically Gundam did it too, yes, but it was better. Hey, remember the episode where the robot was making a giant pizza? That was hilarious. Let's do that again this episode, it'll be a gut buster just like the last time. God, these school segments suck. It's not like Lelouch has that problem, Callan. You know, I almost forgot this series had a plot for a second. It turns out Lelouch's fears of him and his sister being made political tools weren't ungrounded after all. As he finds out, Nunnally is due to become the Governor General of Zone 11. Charles is really just being built up more and more as this detestable figure. He even wants to
kill God.
And no, this killing God plotline doesn't end up having a satisfying payoff. I'm betting the writers felt that, this being a mech series, they just had to put some mystical, magical nonsense somewhere in the final act. Lelouch goes to save Nunnally, but oh, what's this? In a shocking turn of events, it turns out she's actually going along with all of this. She's carrying on Yuffie's will, and Zero is evil and dumb and stupid. Though, this isn't really that surprising a decision for the character. A twist that doesn't feel contrived? I must be watching the wrong show, this can't be the Code Geass I know and love. Nunnally becoming an enemy of Zero sends Lelouch over the edge. And thus we get one of the worst hero's lowest point moments I've ever laid witness to. Unable to cope with the fact his sister is working with Britannia, Lelouch turns to hard drugs. Wait, what? I know people tend to have a problem with angsty protagonists, but this is on a whole other level. But it gets even better when Callan tries to get him to break the habit. Oh, too bad, Lelouch. But it looks like Rollo's willing to fulfill the needs that Callan won't. The first time I saw this scene, I could barely believe it was real. Seriously, this is on the same level as some shitty erotic doujinshi. Apparently, Rollo did the job better than any woman could because this snaps him out of his angst spell, along with him seeing his classmates shooting some fireworks, I guess. Who cares? All I want to know is, do they look round or flat when you look at them from the side? Meanwhile, the Black Knights are fighting the Brits on the sea. And then Lelouch returns and immediately comes up with a plan to capsize their ships. How did you know those ships were right above that? You literally just showed up. You had no time to come up with a plan. After the battle, it looks like Lelouch has another plan to pull out of his ass, as he proposes a truce between the Black Knights and Britannia. Britannia actually accepts to meet with him, for some reason. While Lelouch is no doubt hatching another nefarious scheme in preparation, we find out that Suzaku's live command is still active, even a year later. Remember that episode in season 1 when Lelouch tried to test the maximum duration of his Geass on that one student? Well, turns out that didn't matter because it just seemingly lasts forever. It's never clearly explained what the limits of this command are. What if Suzaku got super AIDS or turned 120 years old? Would the Geass still keep him from dying? All of this is conjecture, of course, but it's pretty funny to think about since it's never clearly stated. Now, hoo boy, this next part is one of the most ridiculous in the series, which is fucking saying something. So, Lelouch's proposal is that he'll go along with the whole administered zone of Japan shit that Nunnally is trying to bring back, but he asks for Britannia to exile Zero. Obviously, he wouldn't be able to lead the Black Knights if he accepts his exile, but even still, we all know what happened the last time Lelouch said he was going to peacefully talk things over regarding the administered zone of Japan, right? But of course, everything always goes according to Lelouch's plan. Well, except for that Mao incident, but we don't talk about that. So yeah, they accept. Now, a crowd of a million people have gathered for the administered zone of Japan announcement, and Lelouch comes in through a broadcast. Now, can you guess what his plan is? The episode is titled Miracle of a Million. Take a wild guess. Right as Lelouch is about to be officially exiled, members of the Black Knights in the audience create a massive cloud of smoke, big enough to cover the whole million people. And when the smoke clears, Okay. I don't even need this anything. This shit speaks for itself. But this is a full analysis, as I said, so I guess I have to go into detail. So first off, how did a million people get these Zero suits in the first place? What, do they mass produce them on the black market and ship them to a million citizens without being traced back? I guess there are different colorations in some of the Zero suits, so I guess everyone made their own? Which is just as preposterous as the alternative. Weren't there babies in the audience? Where'd they go? Did they put on the Zero suits and just grow into them? Maybe the parents ate them to prove their loyalty to Zero. I don't know, man, an absurd situation like this deserves an absurd hypothetical. Not everyone was wearing a backpack either, so where'd they pull the suits? Out of their asses, just like Lelouch pulled this shit out of his ass? And how in all that is holy did Lelouch even get together 1 million people? Let alone in the short time frame of a single day. Because keep in mind, he was still in angst mode last episode, and he didn't even know about Nunnally's plan until a few days ago. What if some of them were just stupid and didn't know what a VPN was? What if one of them was a Britannian loyalist? You're seriously trying to tell me that the Black Knights contacted a million people and this plan didn't get leaked to Britannia, intentionally or otherwise? If Suzaku, someone who's experienced tragedy by the direct hand of Britannia, is still willing to fight for them, surely there are some more Tories among the Japanese. Also, don't fucking tell me he Geassed them all, because there's no way he could have issued a command to a million people in the span of a day or two without causing a major scene and blowing his cover. Some people's biggest problem with Lelouch is his angst surrounding Nunnally. My biggest problem with Lelouch is that he's written as a genius when the writers don't know how a genius works, and they just think a genius is capable of the impossible. This could not possibly happen. Ever. If that wasn't galaxy brain enough, Lelouch's plan when he requested to be exiled was, get this, have all million people in Zero suits also be exiled. The logic being, hey, they can't tell who the real Zero is, so they'll just have to exile everybody. Bruh. But yes, they actually do it. Again. And all million people pack onto a boat to China.
We're going to China.
Damn, what a huge maximum capacity on this ship. For reference, the maximum capacity of the Titanic was only about 3,500 people. Our next arc involves the Black Knights in China. To be honest, I completely forgot these guys appeared in Season 1 after my first viewing. The arc isn't very interesting either. Something having to do with a lolly empress and a political marriage with a Britannian prince. There's also this one guy called Zheng Ke who's in love with the empress. It's mostly pretty boring, but something very noteworthy, to say the least, happens towards the beginning of the arc. Keep in mind that this occurs the episode immediately after the Million Zeros nonsense. Lelouch goes as Zero to congratulate the Empress Tanji on her marriage. There, he encounters his half-brother Schneisel for the first time on screen. Yeah, that guy from the first season who I neglected to mention because he barely had any presence. Lelouch challenges his brother to a chess game because, well, of course. What ensues is, without exaggeration, the worst chess game ever put to screen, or at least the worst one I've ever seen. The scene starts towards the end of the match. Now, I'm no chess expert, so I can't really comment on how likely this board is. What I can comment on is Schneisel's bold move to goad Lelouch. He moves his king right into check. A move so bad, it's illegal. And despite having technically won the game, Lelouch doesn't even take it, like Schneisel has some kind of ace up his sleeve, even though he is literally in check on his opponent's turn, and shouldn't have been able to even make that move in the first place. Look, I know this scene is more for showing what kind of characters these two are. Lelouch can't accept an easy victory or whatever. But when someone in, for instance, Sangatsu no Lion makes an unusual move or has an unorthodox strategy, it can say something about the nature of the character, and they're still playing by the rules of the damn game. What makes things worse is this travesty takes place during a filler arc. Seriously, name one thing that Lelouch does in China that helps him with his rebellion against Britannia. The justification is that once they take down the corrupt members of the Chinese government, they can gain China as an ally against Britannia. But it's mentioned in a later episode that the Chinese Federation was essentially dissolved after this arc, so not even that happened. It's all just a bunch of time-wasting. Not to mention, the fights in this season are already a noticeable step down from the first few fights in the series. I've mentioned before my distaste for the tactics in Code Geass and how the battle sequences aren't as smart as the writers think they are, but they've gotten even worse now. Oh no, we're cornered. Just kidding, I'll immediately pull out my overpowered nightmare that can block all your bullets and destroy every one of your mechs instantly. Screw having a cathartic victory that was earned with blood, sweat, and tears. We'll just have the engineer spout some bullshit about how she modified Lelouch's nightmare off-screen, so it's an instant win item now. You sure said it, Lelouch. If Kaguya, another side character who joined up with the Black Knights, could already tell from the beginning how much the Empress mattered to Zhongkai, why didn't they just inform him of their plan in the first place? It would have saved them a lot of trouble, not having to fight another powerful mecha pilot. Maybe it was just too much of a hassle for them to put any more thought into this, just like how it's not worth it for me to put any more thought into this glorified filler. So back in Japan, and what better way to follow up a filler arc than another filler episode? And this is one of the worst episodes in the series on top of it. A statement that would be much more believable if heroin junkie Lelouch and 1 million Zeros didn't happen just earlier this same season. So, honest to God, Lelouch's battle maid was impersonating him while he was in China and set him up on dates with 108 girls. Not even an actual harem series has the balls to pull this. With all the sexual tension between Lelouch and the entire body of female students, what better time than now to have a school festival? This one is dubbed Cupid Day. The premise is that everyone is wearing a hat. Boys are wearing blue, girls are wearing pink. And anyone who takes another person's hat is now dating that person. How wacky! This whole scenario is just so anime, and I don't mean that in a good way. So this is what happens when Code Geass actually tries to be funny, huh? After that travesty, we finally get back into plot, only for it to be as cheesy as the filler. Jeremiah pops back into the story as a Socratite cyborg. Yeah, and he also has a Geass canceller. And he just so happens to use it as Shirley passes by. Talk about conveniences, eh? It's not mentioned whether this was intentional or not on Jeremiah's part, but the result is that Shirley's memories of Lelouch and Zero come back. Her arc that was retroactively killed in the first season comes back, just so Shirley can be killed herself. Whoops. So ultimately, Shirley was a filler character who only existed to, I guess, have this tragic scene for Lelouch? I don't really see what kind of change this was meant to bring to his character, because he goes ahead to do shit he was already going to do in the first place, wage an assault on Britannia. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Jeremiah is back, and this time, it's personal. He wants Lelouch's head on a silver platter. Lelouch realizes a direct assault is pointless since neither he nor Rollo can use Geass on him. He finds out that bullets are also pointless due to Jeremiah's Socratite enhancements. So how does Lelouch beat him? If you said by pulling something out of his ass at the last second, then ding ding, that's exactly what he does. Even though he had no idea that Jeremiah was made out of Socratite until about 2 minutes ago, he somehow had a train prepared with Socratite jamming devices. In this public train station, no less. What, did he read the script beforehand? I know some people aren't bothered by contrivances and plot holes, and that's fine. Something I absolutely can't forgive, however, is the decision regarding Jeremiah's character here. So, Jeremiah. Up until this point, I'd say he's the one character I liked unironically, aside from maybe C2. He's been consistent, a proud warrior who, due to his pride, becomes obsessed with killing Lelouch, the one who has stained his honor. Now, all of that gets thrown right into the dumpster when Lelouch tells him of his royal blood. Jeremiah then immediately disregards any grudge he might have had regarding that whole orange business and becomes loyal to Lelouch. He is the son of Queen Marianne, who he was originally faithful to, after all. But see, here's the issue. Lelouch is still trying to, you know, topple the government that Marianne was still a part of, and Lelouch's father Charles is still alive. You'd think if he was loyal to the Empress, he would also be loyal to the Emperor, especially considering Charles saved his fucking life. But no, let's just have this character go against everything he was initially, because why not? I hate to say this about my favorite character here, but at that halfway point in season 1, they really just should have killed off Jeremiah. It would have been a lot better than what happened to his character in this season. Meanwhile, Shirley encounters Rollo and asks if there's anything she can do to help him and Lelouch. But come on, Rollo isn't going to share his man with no harlot now. Should have seen this coming. So here's a funny, I mean, tragic scene. This is a tragedy, after all. Hey, you ever seen Hamlet? Great play. No relation to Code Geass or anything. I just wanted to say that you should read it. It's one of Shakespeare's finest. As I mentioned earlier, Shirley dies in this scene, but something interesting happens. Lelouch is pleading for her to not die, and in his desperation, he commands her to live on, just like Suzaku. Now, this scene is a bit confusing to me, and I'm not exactly sure what the intent was. It's possible this is trying to show the limits of Lelouch's powers, and that someone can't survive a fatal wound even if Lelouch commands them to survive. We'll get to see just how bullshit the powers are with Suzaku later on, though. The thing is, this command shouldn't even work in the first place since Lelouch already issued her a command in Season 1. She has those red eyes, though, implying the command worked. Unfortunately, I can't say if the command was able to get through due to Jeremiah's Geass canceller, or if the command didn't work and this is just some artistic decision that isn't meant to be taken literally, because the show never tells us. You would think, though, that if Jeremiah's Geass canceller can indeed make it so Lelouch can issue more commands to the same person, that he would want to keep Jeremiah by his side at all times to get infinite Geass usage. We never get a similar situation again, and Lelouch doesn't ever bring this question up, so I guess we'll never know. Oddly enough, Lelouch doesn't seem too pissed off at Rollo for, you know, killing one of his friends. Oddly, though, this moment, of all moments, is where he decides to go on the offensive against V2 and Emperor Charles. It's not like he wasn't going to do this eventually, but the show seems to imply he's only doing it this instant because he's mad at Geass users? It doesn't really make much sense. If anything, you'd think Lelouch's anger would be directed towards Rollo right now. Yes, he is supposedly planning to kill Rollo, but he never gets the chance to act on it. While this was all going on, Cornelia was investigating the sketchy Geass experiments being conducted by Charles and V2. She ends up running into V2, and she does this. Ah, good, I was getting sick of this guy's terrible voice acting. Oh, he's just immortal, I guess. Amazing. V2 gets a call from Lelouch about how he's going to get owned and, he's already here. This pacing is so awkward. Lelouch just out of nowhere launches a full-scale attack on the big bads of Britannia, along with their creepy manufactured Geass children. It feels like Lelouch could have just done this at any time, but only did so now because, he was feeling sad today because of Shirley. Seriously, there's absolutely no build-up to this confrontation. One episode, Lelouch was fighting Jeremiah, and then the next episode, well, I guess it's just time to fight the main antagonists now. You'd think with the 39 episodes they had, they would have done a better job at leading up to this moment, but nope. The pizza episodes were essential, guys, trust me. During the battle against V2, V2 states that Rollo's Geass literally stops his heart every time he uses it. I guess it was sort of hinted at, during the Cupid Day of all things, that Rollo's Geass does take a toll on him. If he was using it on a wide area to freeze a large amount of people in place, yeah, that'd probably tire him out, but you'd think Rollo would have mentioned this heart-stopping business to Lelouch, seeing as how he trusts him so much. It's such a shoddy way to foreshadow Rollo's death. V2 just offhandedly says, oh yeah, if you use this too much, you'll die, and then he dies 5 episodes later. Come on, guys, you could have had more foreshadowing than just this one line, and you could have been more subtle about it. The fight ends with V2's mech getting totaled, and him lying defeated on the ground. V2's goons say he'll be fine, because his body is indestructible, but then he's killed by Charles anyway. Lelouch is then transported to the weird celestial dimension that Charles has been seen hanging out in on a few occasions. The Sword of Akasha. Lelouch needs to deliver the killing blow to Charles, though he can't make direct eye contact with him as Charles has his own Geass he can use on Lelouch that way. So he decides on a more indirect method. If Lelouch's Geass can still work even as reflected light, then I would assume Charles's can as well, though he is a 60-year-old man, so his reaction time probably isn't as good, I guess. The king is dead! Oh, I guess not. Long live the king? Yeah, Charles is just immortal now. Because killing him the normal way would have just been too easy, huh? But wait a minute, shouldn't he be stuck in an endless loop of trying to kill himself then? The Geass was implied to work in the sense that Charles got mind-controlled. The command for Suzaku to live wasn't a one-off event, so why should the command for Charles to die be a one-off thing? Once again, the Geass's powers behave arbitrarily due to plot convenience. I should have made a counter for this shit. None of that stuff is ever going to get cleared up, but we do get to learn more about the Geass, as well as C2's wish. So basically, when a Geass user gets to a certain point in their abilities, they become able to take away the immortality of the one who gave them their Geass. They then lose their Geass, but become immortal themselves as a trade-off. C2 had formed a contract with V2, and then V2 had formed a contract with Charles. This is how Charles was able to just now take away the quote-unquote code of immortality from V2. And yes, C2's goal this entire time was to have Lelouch get to a point in his Geass progression so that he'd be able to kill her, since she's fed up with immortality. Though I don't see the point in grooming Lelouch to begin with, since Charles is also capable of doing that right now and is more than willing to. Charles then banishes Lelouch to the thought dimension, because that's a thing, I guess. And here's where the show attempts a sort of character assassination on Lelouch. Whoa, him wearing the mask as Zero is symbolic of how he wears a mask to hide who he is as a person. What a circular piece of symbolism. What, did Roger Waters write this shit? This attempt at making Lelouch seem more complex than he actually is too little too late. Also, this scene is just poorly integrated and sort of comes out of nowhere. Speaking of poorly integrated into the scene, C2's backstory. C2 was lonely as a child, and so her Geass was to make other people love her. But it turns out the person who gave her that Geass had only done so that C2 could kill her one day. And she does, and loses her Geass. Wow, that's a pretty underwhelming backstory. I don't really have much more to say than that. Back to Lelouch, he ends up breaking out of the thought dimension all by himself, somehow, with no explanation for how he did so. Charles is about to take away C2's code of immortality, but Lelouch says, "No!" C2 decides she doesn't really want to die after all and runs away from Charles. Lelouch retreats with C2, only for him to find out that she's suddenly developed amnesia. It's Japanese writing from the 2000s, so it had to happen at some point. It was 2008. roughly around the cutoff for when this trope really became tired, but I'm not saying it's a shitty writing decision to include amnesia. Amnesia can actually be done well if the reason for the amnesia is explained and the character actually has an interesting backstory that ties into the current events of the plot. It seems kind of odd though to have C2 develop amnesia right after her backstory is revealed, but guess what? The amnesia only lasts for about 3.5 episodes. This makes me believe that the writers just couldn't come up with a more natural way to reveal a certain future twist. And believe me, I have some thoughts on that twist that I'll get to soon enough. It was a bit of a nice touch, though, to have Lelouch provide the opening narration for the next few episodes instead of the usual C2. You know what? I changed my mind. I'm fine with this, C2. Lelouch calls Suzaku. 16 entire episodes after Suzaku found out the identity of Zero, he asks this obvious question.
Lelouch, kimi wa Zero ka?
Awkward. With few options left, Lelouch attempts to negotiate with Suzaku to save Nunnally, because that went so well last time. Suzaku does agree to meet with Lelouch, though on the condition that Lelouch comes alone. Lelouch actually does go alone, or so it seems. At this point, even assuming Suzaku is ready to talk things out, it would be naive for the viewer to assume any agreement is going to be reached between the two. Their talk boils down to Suzaku getting pissed at Lelouch, and Lelouch being too much of an idiot to simply clarify his past mistakes, such as the deaths of Yuffie and Shirley. I know the show wants me to, but it's hard to see the conflict between these two as gray when Suzaku is such a massive out-and-out hypocrite and the worst things Lelouch has done are simply due to clumsy mistakes. I made a mistake by killing my father and trying to solve a conflict through violence, so to atone for this, I'm going to join the military of a country committing genocide. After Suzaku kicks the shit out of Lelouch for a couple minutes, he actually entertains the idea of working with Lelouch, so long as he adheres to his codes of justice. But of course, at the worst possible moment, the Britannians come in and capture Lelouch. Suzaku wasn't trying to set him up, but he doesn't attempt to defend himself either when Lelouch accuses him of being a traitor. You know what? Forget what I said earlier. At this point, the moral conflict between these two is one of idiocy more than hypocrisy. Schneisel here thinks he's got Lelouch cornered, but of course, he had a plan all along. Does this count as some sort of reverse, indirect sissy hypnosis? Well, anyway, now that negotiations have failed, it's time for another fight sequence. This is Code Geass R2, so as always, the tactics of this battle are essentially non-existent. Especially when Callan joins the fray with her stolen OP super mech that obliterates everything.
Boy, I sure do hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
After all the nameless mooks are dead, I mean, they might have had names, but I forgot them rather quickly, Miss Plot Armor encounters Mr. Plot Armor himself. Suzaku's been armed with Freya, which is essentially a nuke that was developed by Nina Einstein. Einstein made a nuke. Real clever. You know what else is clever? Trusting the altruist to use a nuclear weapon. Suzaku would rather die than use... Oh... Wait, this doesn't make any sense. If Freya had actually hit Callan, I'm pretty sure Suzaku would have died in the blast due to his close proximity to Callan, but I guess we wouldn't have had this tragic event where Suzaku inadvertently causes the death of Nunnally. Why are you even freaking out? You're the one who told him to use it, dumbass. It's the classic end of the second act moment. Lelouch has reached his lowest point, aside from the part where he was strung out on heroin, that is. The one he's been fighting for all this time has died, and now, get this, the Britannians have gotten the Black Knights to turn on him. I know I'm sounding like a broken record, but this scene really makes no sense. Schneisel and company meet with some of the top brass in the Black Knights and inform them that 1, Zero is actually Lelouch, who's also a Britannian prince. They also state that 2, Lelouch has the power of Geass. But really, this doesn't feel like enough justification to turn on Lelouch, and then work with the Britannians against him. Lelouch clearly has the same goal as the members of the Black Knights, the liberation of Japan. Is it really so preposterous that someone on the inside would become disillusioned with his government and rebel? And if the Black Knights now believe that they were only following Lelouch because he commanded them to follow him with the Geass, doesn't that alone disprove that assertion? Given the fact that Lelouch's Geass is absolute, they would literally not have the ability to turn on him, regardless of the information they find out. And it's not like they know the weaknesses of the Geass and that Lelouch can only use it once per person, so as far as the Black Knights know, Lelouch would have had ample opportunity to control them. Maybe they just assumed that Lelouch is stupid and doesn't know how to use his Geass most effectively, which is at least true. More than any of this though, the Black Knights are absolute buffoons for believing evidence that could have been easily fabricated and is being supplied to them by their enemies, who lead a dictatorship and already produce anti-Japanese propaganda. Why is it that every time there's a significant turning point in this series, it's always riddled with plot holes beyond the point of believability? I want to take a moment to clarify something. I do not believe the quality of something is strongly inversely proportional to the amount of plot holes it has. Even R2 is far from the worst anime has to offer. But when the politics of your political mecha show aren't believable, and the superpowers of your fantasy action series aren't believable, then that does a lot to hurt the coherence of the setting you've created. If a story doesn't make sense logically, then it should at least make sense emotionally, though Code Geass also fails at this, since the climactic moments come across as absurd or even unintentionally humorous rather than shocking or tragic. Back on topic, I find it a bit odd that the most controversial part of episode 19 isn't the Black Knights betraying Lelouch, but Rollo returning to save Lelouch. More specifically, Lelouch seeming to flip-flop in regards to his feelings for Rollo. Honestly, I don't think this scene is great either. Keep in mind, I was never sold on how Rollo became so loyal to Lelouch in the first place. But on the other hand, since he is loyal to him, it would have been weirder for him to suddenly abandon Lelouch after that one barrage of insults that was clearly made under a condition of extreme stress and grief. On the other hand again, it is odd that Lelouch would so readily see Rollo as a true brother now, since in the previous instances where we see Lelouch's thoughts about him, Lelouch is plotting to kill Rollo. That and Rollo is guilty of killing Shirley, but maybe Lelouch forgot about her, just like I did by this point. Okay, maybe this scene doesn't make much sense after all, but my point is, it's not even the worst sequence in the episode, let alone one of the worst in the season. Plus, if you're actually invested in these characters and can tolerate a little melodrama, then I can kind of see why someone would find Rollo's sacrifice emotional. A little. But if we're going to complain about inconsistent character writing, something I absolutely won't defend is Suzaku's sudden heel face turn. Up until this point, Suzaku has been idealistic to a fault, but now he completely inverts his beliefs and decides to overthrow the Emperor. Now, I'm perfectly fine with a character undergoing a dramatic change, but usually this is done as a result of a turning point in the story, not in service of one. What makes this change even more mind-boggling is that it comes right after Suzaku inadvertently created more destruction, this time causing the death of one of his closest friends. If anything, this should serve as another example of flawed means always leading to terrible ends. It's bad enough having a character change on a dime just to drive the plot forward, but the prior events in this case actually make this shift even more nonsensical. And oh boy, if we're going to talk about nonsensical, I'd be negligent not to mention the absurdity of one of the biggest twists in R2. And it actually has to do with a character I haven't talked about so far. Astute Code Geass buffs might have noticed, I never mentioned the new Knights of the Round members introduced towards the beginning of the season, Anya and Gino. Considering I legitimately had to go back and double check what their names were, I didn't really have to. These characters hadn't done anything of interest, and the only reason why Gino was introduced, if I had to guess, was so they'd have another mecha figure to sell. So here's the big reveal. Lelouch's mother was actually alive this whole time. Yep. When Marianne got shot by V2, little Anya just happened to witness her death. And conveniently, Marianne had a Geass to transfer her soul. And she did just that. So, this entire time, Marianne's soul has been residing in this pink-haired lolly. Like, what the hell? This might be one of the worst plot twists I've seen in an anime. You have this breadcrumb trail of clues as to who could have possibly killed Marianne, only for none of it to matter. Oddly enough, it's only after this point that we find out it was in fact V2 who killed Marianne. Isn't it convenient that Marianne's Gios just so happened to be one that could save her life in that specific situation? And her Gios isn't even integrated into the plot in any other meaningful way. It exists solely for this aha gotcha moment. Also, Marianne is revealed to be working with Charles, so Lelouch has to fight both of his parents now, I guess. Who could have predicted this tragedy? It's bad enough that both of these scenes are in the same episode, but I guess what they say about bad things coming in threes is true, as there's another scene I take issue with, and that's this scene with Lelouch. This scene right here completely destroys the entire balance of the Gios, and makes every single other Gios command in the series seem hilariously short-sighted. It's a case of asking the genie for more wishes, isn't it? One of the supposed handicaps of the Gios is that Lelouch can only use it once per person, but if the command, from now on you'll do as I say, works, then why doesn't he always use that command? Lelouch is supposed to be a calculated schemer who always knows exactly what to say, kill the Japanese aside, but what's the point when he can just do this? What makes this all the worse is that he never attempted this before, or even asked C2 if it was possible. It's the first time he's doing this, and the series is nearly over. And he's using it on some random goons when he could have used it on someone more powerful like Cornelia or Jeremiah when he had the chance to in season 1. Wouldn't it have made more thematic sense as well for him to have made use of this command more often? Instead of the numerous times where he commanded people to kill themselves in order to escape temporary danger, he could have been constantly creating disposable pawns. Hey, there's the chess metaphor. This could even tie in to a big character moment for him where there's an analogy of him having so many pawns but not any valuable pieces, or people, in his life. Aside from Nunnally, obviously. Hell, he probably could have used those soldiers he killed in the first episode to infiltrate Britannia from the inside and assassinate most of the important figures. The fact that he could have done this makes the whole journey here seem overly roundabout. Lelouch, C2, and Suzaku all confront Charles and Marianne together in the Sword of Akasha, and it's here that we finally learn what their plans are. Charles wishes to create a world in which lies and facades will be eradicated completely. He and his brother grew up in a family where kin were killing kin in order to obtain power, with even their own mother being assassinated. There are definitely some parallels between Charles and his son. Their motivations were shaped from a young age and were the result of their tragic experiences. It's pretty childish, though, for a 60-year-old man to believe that humans will stop killing each other just because they understand each other. They'll just be more open in their hatred. But I guess he is the antagonist, so his motivations have to be flawed if the show wants us to root for Lelouch to defeat him. Still, Lelouch's motives definitely make a lot more sense than his father's. Britannia commits war crimes, so he wants to take them down so there will be less war crimes, essentially. Marianne's been in league with Charles for a while, and this is when she, Charles, and V2 had made pacts with C2. Wait, you'd think V2 would have known what Marianne's Gios was, and would have done a better job of making sure there wasn't anyone around that Marianne could have potentially transferred her soul to. Yet another case of convenient stupidity. It's then revealed that Charles secretly wanted to protect Lelouch by keeping him away from V2. Now, I could sit here and list every reason why that's stupid and doesn't make any sense, just like I've done before in this video. But above all else, this moment just doesn't feel earned. There was no foreshadowing leading up to this moment, and it goes completely against any of Charles's previous actions. A good plot twist needs to do more than merely catch the viewer off guard. It has to make sense within the context of the story. And as an added bonus, it can provide more nuance to previous scenes. This achieves neither, because there's nothing to indicate before this that Charles was a loving father who was always looking to protect his children. This is the same guy who literally said to Lelouch's face that the only use he and his sister had were as political tools. And then he goes on to say that all along he really wanted the same thing as Euphemia and Nunnally, when he's the fucking emperor and could have done that from the fucking start. I'm sorry, but it's hard to believe the same guy who was maniacally laughing at Yuffie's genocide attempt and subsequent death had the same goals as her all along. Also, he somehow made Nunnally blind with his Geass in order for her to not be able to learn anything that might put her in danger. Sure. So how does Charles plan on achieving his goal exactly? Well, he's going to use the Sword of Akasha to kill God, which in the Code Geass universe is basically the collective unconscious. How and why such a thing exists is never explained, but Charles's plan would create a universal human hive mind, as far as I can tell. The sword apparently requires 2 Geass users to operate, which is why Charles didn't just use it himself at any other point and needed Marianne to assist him. This is overly convenient, but the bigger issue is that the existence of the Sword of Akasha is already absurd to begin with, and the writers didn't even bother to explain anything about it. I'm fine with leaving some things to interpretation, but this is ridiculous. Of course, Lelouch isn't having any of that, and after attempting the old talk no jutsu on his parents, performs the most asinine act in the series. Man, you know what this reminds me of? Hamlet. Remember when Hamlet used his mind control powers on God in order to erase the existence of Claudius? Oh, that was the best part. To add insult to injury for Charles and Marianne, C2 is saved at the last second because she realized they only care about themselves. As if that weren't apparent enough already. The plot is in a sort of awkward spot at the moment now. The main antagonists have been defeated, so there's not really anything in the way of Lelouch conquering Britannia. So he does. He even somehow talks Suzaku into joining him. Uh-oh, guys, Lelouch is evil now. Sorry, but after Lelouch's whole heroic speech against Charles, I don't buy it. I don't think the writers actually wanted the audience to believe Lelouch had turned evil, at least not after this end of episode cliffhanger. But as always, we're not given a glimpse into the mind of Lelouch to find out just exactly what his endgame is. Well, we find out what the name of his plan is, Zero Requiem. Sounds ominous enough. In order to achieve that plan, Lelouch has to clean up Charles's Knights of the Round and the Black Knights. I'll admit, there hasn't been a real sense of tension in the series for a while, and with these next fights, there's even less. This is apparent the moment we see Suzaku on the field. As per usual, he instantly destroys everyone. The most laughable moment comes when he battles a Knight of the Round, who turns out to be a Geass user. His ability is that he can see the future actions of his opponents, though he seems more like a new type from Gundam based on how his power is displayed. Suzaku somehow defeats him not through sheer willpower, but because of the fucking command telling him to live. Kinda funny how the guy who could see the future died in less than a minute. This shit just flat out overrides another Geass user's abilities. It's not just a psychological thing where Suzaku believes he must live. This command has literally made him impossible to kill. He's just immortal at this point. Sorry, Gundam virgins, but Suzaku's canonically stronger than any new type. After this, Lelouch meets with the United Federation of Nations, because they couldn't have just called it the UN, to negotiate. And by negotiate, I mean, of course, take them over and rule with an iron fist. See, the power of the nations of the Federation is determined by the respective nation's population. The Chinese Federation dissolved earlier, so the country with the highest population is Britannia. You'd think a system like this would have been thought out a bit better, since if Britannia were to join, it would have an overwhelming say on world affairs. We're not exactly told how much of the population Britannia controls at this point. All we know is that they have more than 20%, since the United Federation proposes, if Britannia were to join, Lelouch has to accept only having 20% of the votes. Otherwise, you'd have too big of an advantage. I would assume as long as all of the other nations have a combined total of at least 51%, they could just vote out Britannia every time. If the Chinese Federation was bigger than Britannia, then they'd obviously have no problem doing this. Even if the Chinese Federation dissolved, the people are still there, and since Zhang Ke is here, surely he's representing some of them. It's not really clarified whether the people of China went on to form their own separate nations, how many nations there are, how many joined the United Federation, and what the population was that joined the Federation. Maybe the show is being so vague as to make the China arc seem like it wasn't filler, but I won't be fooled by this. But it turns out to be irrelevant anyways, since Lelouch ends up taking over the United Federation by force. After this venture, Lelouch gets a call from Schneisel, who plans to fight him. At first it appears to Lelouch that Schneisel wants to become emperor after defeating him. But the camera pans down, and we see... Okay, forget the shocking twist of Nunnally being the final opponent of her brother. Nunnally was caught in a nuclear blast that destroyed the entire area, and she's somehow still here, entirely unscathed. And they don't even try to bullshit some reason as to how she could possibly be alive after that. She just is. Yeah, there's a throwaway line about Schneisel saving her, but it's not actually said how he saved her. I guess we needed someone to fulfill the hypocrisy quota now that Suzaku isn't serving genocidal maniacs anymore, and Nunnally is already doing a good job at it. When Suzaku asks why she's using nuclear weapons now, this is her response. I mean, yeah. Man, you know your logic's all sorts of fucked when Suzaku, of all people's the voice of reason. Looks like Cornelia has a stronger moral compass than Nunnally, cause she's horrified when she finds out Schneisel just killed an entire city of people. She attempts to fight against him, but Schneisel promptly has her gunned down. Alas, even though there's not much for her to do at this point in the plot, she still winds up surviving. Truthfully, it's difficult for me to see this as a legendary series, even putting aside all of the Titanic-sized plot holes and conveniences, when we're in the final moments of the show and it's still pulling so many punches. Even that guy who was simping for Cornelia somehow survived Freya in episode 18. Freya has to be the most ineffective nuke in fiction. And now we've reached the penultimate battle, Lelouch versus Schneisel and Nunnally. Schneisel sure is confident about this too. What about that point when you failed to capture Lelouch? What about that chess match, buddy? And what can I say about the battle sequence itself? It's no Return of the King, that's for sure. Blah blah blah, characters talk about fighting for their future, and Suzaku stops a nuke with a 0.04 second time window. I've marathoned this series 3 times now, and every time I get to this point, so much stupid shit has happened, I don't even bat an eye anymore. Schneisel, the man who has never lost to Lelouch, loses to Lelouch. What a shocker. He couldn't even hear the 2 guys behind him being taken hostage while Lelouch walked in. Schneisel, bro, all of this could have been avoided if you and all your guards just wore sunglasses. What an amateur. Shockingly, the reporter character is actually killed off. He doesn't even wake up in a hospital bed the next episode. Sorry man, you haven't been an interesting character for a good 40 plus episodes anyway. For the final confrontations of the show, Lelouch has a bitter reunion with Nunnally, while Suzaku faces off with Callan. Callan actually ends up defeating Suzaku, and he appears to be caught in the explosion of Lancelot. I don't know though, we haven't had the best track record when it comes to characters actually dying. Meanwhile, Lelouch tries to obtain Damocles, the controller for Freya, from Nunnally. However, it wouldn't be a Code Geass scene without some eerily convenient timing, as just before Lelouch arrives, Nunnally regains her vision, breaking free from Charles's Geass. Well, I'd say this is overly convenient, but it's not like Lelouch can't just take Damocles by force from a cripple in a wheelchair. I know you're lanky man, but you've got to at least have more upper body strength than your sister. Even so, the scene is written as though it's a lose-lose for Lelouch. Either he doesn't take Damocles and his ambitions end here, in addition to him being executed after all is said and done, or he uses Geass on the last person he ever wanted to in order to end the war. He doesn't try to just take it from her by force like I suggested, and he instead tries to convince her through talking. Nunnally is adamantly against her brother though. When called out on using Damocles, she responds as thus. Damocles is the symbol of hatred. Hatred is gathered here. After hearing this, Lelouch finally decides to use his Geass on Nunnally, forcing her to give him Democles. Lelouch now has total control of the entire world. And now, at long last, we've arrived at the famed conclusion. It's often labeled as one of the greatest endings in anime, and even people who will agree with many of my problems with R2 still hold it in high regard. It's here that we finally learn the meaning of Zero Requiem. Lelouch is parading the captured Black Knights down the street when suddenly, in the distance, a man dressed as Zero appears. Only one man could blitz past all of that security. As Zero is about to kill Lelouch, a flashback reveals that it is indeed Suzaku in the Zero suit, and this was all part of Lelouch's Zero Requiem. With the hatred of the world concentrated toward Lelouch, Suzaku, as Zero, will become the hero who slayed the villainous tyrant Lelouch. Britannia will finally fall, and since Schneisel now serves Zero, he will put his power behind Suzaku. Side note, but since the effects of Geass don't necessarily go away when the user dies, does Lelouch plan for Suzaku to live on as Zero forever? Jokes aside, the team went above and beyond for the presentation of this scene, and it makes me all the more confused by how poorly paced and executed a lot of the earlier scenes in the series were. The steady musical crescendo, the slow motion of Suzaku's strike, the gradually building dread and anticipation. And when Lelouch is actually run through, silence. Then Lelouch finally passes, and those flutes come in. Such a great ending scene. Before it was undone by the sequel movie, that is. Unfortunately, while this ending is great out of context, it doesn't quite reach that, and I'll say again, legendary status due to the absolute train wreck that was the rest of the series. Take Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood, for instance. There's a real sense of catharsis in the conclusion, largely because the journey to the ending was so gripping. You got to know these characters well, and laugh or cry, the conclusions to their arcs felt earned. For Zero Requiem, I have the distinct feeling that the team knew how they wanted to end the series, but couldn't come up with a consistently well-thought-out 49 episodes to reach that point. There were so many subpar episodes, and it's only at the very end where you have a 5-minute segment where it actually feels like they cared about the presentation and pacing. Though, considering Lelouch is indeed the protagonist of further sequels, maybe Sunrise regretted making this ending. Considering the fact Fugatsu no Lelouch is an entire decade removed from the end of R2, I think the ending should be judged in the context of the show on its own. However, the fact that this sacrifice ends up being reversed does cheapen the moment a bit revisiting this show now. And regardless, my final verdict on R2 still remains that it's an absolute mess. Season 1 had some pretty dumb moments and a lot of wasted potential, but R2 has significantly higher amounts of schlock. But I don't want you to have the impression that I think Code Geass is the worst thing ever. Even as far as massively popular anime goes, you can definitely do much, much worse. In fact, while this may come off as a surprise after this massive rant, I still enjoyed Code Geass. It's definitely not anywhere near the same level of quality as other mid-2000s classics, and I still believe the series is quite bad, but that doesn't mean I didn't enjoy my time with it. I always wanted to know what ridiculous thing would happen next, even if I was just watching it as dumb, memeable fun and wasn't taking it seriously. Sunrise set out to make a show that anyone could enjoy, and even if I didn't necessarily enjoy it for the intended reasons, you can still consider that a success on the part of the team. And you can bet that I'll be watching the sequel season whenever that comes out. Now if you'll excuse me, I'm going to order some Pizza Hut.